Well, who was Transition Winnipeg? Well, it's a really a local expression of the now global transition time. That started in the United Kingdom in 2006. It shares the view that post-peak oil will impose on communities a non-negotiable limit on sustainable growth and the resulting need for an orderly energy descent plan. I'll be referring to the energy descent plan several times. And I'll just refer to it as the EDAP from now on, the Energy Descent Plan. It's also accepted that climate change and the increasing volatility of global financial markets are realities that will increasingly shape community development options going forward. I just read in the paper today that Alison Redford, Premier of Alberta, has recently stated that energy price fluctuations are reducing provincial revenues. So even right now, we're seeing a lot of volatility in the financial market. Finally, established institutions of governance may require assistance to provide the leadership required to meet these middle and long-term challenges effectively. Transition Winnipeg promotes community-based projects and activities designed to build community connections and ecological resilience, relocalize the regional economy, strengthen food system security, and encourage the recovery and development of skills, knowledge, and technologies necessary to make the transition to a less energy-intensive economy and a healthier way of life. So it really is a community-based organization. And another term that Transition uses a lot is reskilling for a new economy. For instance, Transition Winnipeg is comprised of a number of affiliate organizations. I don't mean to call these organizations. There's a very non-hierarchical approach to it, but we're composed of a number of numerous other affiliate organizations. A few of them are LETS, L-E-T-S, Winnipeg, and this affiliate organization is a local trading network that enables members to exchange goods and services without the need for Canadian currency, which again is a cornerstone of the transition network, or you're having alternative currencies and goods and services are bartered. Sustainable South Osborne is another affiliate organization. Transition North of Winnipeg, Communications Working Group, of which Kurt is also a member, Social Planning Council of Winnipeg, and I'm also a member of the Manitoba Education for Sustainable Development Working Group. So again, the whole aspect of transition network is it's a community of communities, as Joe Clark used to say. It's a network of networks. It's an umbrella organization that fosters ideas, that facilitates communication, that perhaps helps out in fundraising roles. There's a number of public policy analysts that form part of the Transition Network. So if there's another affiliate organization who needs some aid and support in any way, perhaps we can offer that as well. Now, in terms of climate change adaptation, really we have two priorities for Transition Winnipeg. We try to provide an inspirational education, first of all, advocacy and information resource to the community, respecting transition activities and projects elsewhere in Canada and the world. And we also are served to stimulate the formation of neighborhood-based transition projects within Winnipeg. Currently, our signature initiative is, again, the EDAP, the Energy Descent Action Plan. This is headed by James Magnus Johnston, who is a Canadian director for the Centre for the Advancement of the Steady State Economy. The EDAP focuses on our future world and how, with careful planning, we can maintain and even improve our quality of life by weaning ourselves off of fossil fuels. Some examples of the EDAPs include, of course, Totnes in the United Kingdom, Portland, Seattle, and West Marin in Northern California, and a host of others. There are good energy plans and climate change strategies out there, but an EDAP is different because the community leads the way. We envision goals according to the best available science and then set out to achieve them collaboratively. Following this process, the plan will give direction to neighborhood transition groups and the broader community, and we bring the community together to initiate carbon-cutting projects throughout the city. And by the way, too, we do have a website where if you have a proposal to submit as an expert in the topic areas of energy, food, transportation, the built environment, urban planning, local economy, and society and community, and then we'd welcome your proposal. Also, our perspective on climate change adaptation, we feel that a reaction to climate change requires a long-term, deep-seated process of cultural and social redevelopment. And being responsive to short-term weather emergencies applies a different but necessary and complementary set of policies and actions. So we prefer to look at the severe weather as the short-term and then climate change adaptation as the long-term and bring those two strategies together. We need to expand the role of people to include more citizenship education and training activities. In all the emergencies, your first responders will be your neighbors. Therefore, neighbors should be well-trained and knowledgeable. Between acute emergencies, more resources should be available to allow professionals to teach more citizens about the long emergency, preparedness and first response skills. Now we need to adjust psychologically to a new reality. In the past, severe weather episodes were one-off events from which we could expect to return to normal soon after. But as climate change ramps up, there'll be no normal to return to. I refer to a recent Bartley Kivas article in the Free Press, quote, "No government effort to manage Manitoba, and yes, I mean the entire province, will succeed until the populace accepts the notion that we live in a place that is and will always be wet to some extent. Southern Manitoba needs to be viewed as just one part of the vast Red River Basin watershed," end quote. While Kivas does not go so far as to attribute the recent run of Red River floods to anthropogenic climate change, he does mention that it is, quote, commonsensical, end quote, the theory that the frequency of these floods is a sign of climate change. We can expect cumulatively rising costs, shorter rest periods between emergencies, and greater variability in the sorts and intensities of emergencies we have to resolve. Transition Winnipeg has always acknowledged the heart and soul dimension in the challenge of transition. Any climate change adaptation plan can't simply assume that public education and increasing awareness of climate science will be sufficient. People's emotional responses to this information can desensitize their responses and reduce effective coping. People need more than sympathy and the vain hope that things will get back to normal soon.